Asian cultures remapping Southeast Asia. So we're very, very pleased that you could all be here tonight. And we're especially pleased that to start the festivities off, we have the Angkor Dance Troupe perform and entertain us. And to introduce the Angkor Dance Troupe is Diana, who is the vice president, I believe, of the Angkor Dance Troupe and on their board. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Cambodian dance and the dance troupe.
In case you need it.
Do you think I need it?
Or is this better?
There we go. So, dance, drama, and music have always been in Khmer society. These cherished traditions, I'm sure as many of you know, were wiped out during the Khmer Rouge in the 1970s. Artists were among those who were deliberately targeted, with 90% of them being killed or having to flee the country. Today, many Cambodians around the world are working in different communities like Lowell, Massachusetts to rebuild, and they're resurrecting these cultural heritages, music, dance, and it's a testimony to the endurance of this culture. The Angkor Dance Troupe you're about to see was formed in 1986, and last year we celebrated the 25th anniversary, which is really exciting. By two dance teachers and a handful of dancers who had fled the Khmer Rouge and learned the traditions of Cambodian dance in the Thai refugee camps. One of them is Tim Tu, who's the founder right here. When they came to live in Lowell, they brought a passion to continue these cherished traditions and practices and perform to teach others and to see the art preserved for future generations. Today, the dance troupe teaches about 70 to 80 students a week. Some of the students you're going to see today are in high school, some are in college. So the youngest students are 4, 5, and 6. And, one of the dancers you'll see has been dancing over 15 years, so over half her life she's been dancing. So the first dance you'll see, you're going to see two types today, classical and folk dance. So I'll start by explaining a little bit about classical dance. Cambodian classical dance has been connected to sacred rituals in Cambodia for more than 1,000 years. During the Great Angkor Civilization, dancers were performed blessing ceremonies to bring prosperity to the kingdom. More recently, classical dancers have lived and performed in Cambodia's royal palaces. And Tim's grandmother was one of those dancers. Elegant and refined classical dance combines highly stylized positions with gentle movements. Once reserved exclusively for the Cambodian elite, classical dance is now performed for audiences around the world, like yourself, and has become central, a symbol of beauty and the spirituality of Cambodian culture. So the first dance we'll see is called the Choi Chai dance. It's classical dance is, as I mentioned, is an exquisite art form, and it involves hundreds of complex gestures and the impossible curving back of fingers and joints, which you'll witness. Classical dancers used to perform in Cambodia's great temples and ceremonies to appease the gods, and more recently for the king and his family and special guests in the royal court. There was a time when these beautiful dances, as I mentioned, were reserved exclusively for royalty. Chana will perform tonight is called the Choi Chai dance. That dance is of an adolescent princess. It was choreographed and commissioned by one of Cambodia's ruling queens in the early 1960s for her granddaughter, the Princess Bopa Devi. Princess Devi was once a world-renowned classical dancer, is now Cambodia's Minister of Culture. It's interesting to note that the choreography was created by Chi Sami, who was the senior dance master that survived the Pol Pot regime. Her story is detailed in one of the panels in the exhibit at the Moving Cultural Center, which is here in Lowell. Like many dances, like many dancers, Chi Sami hid her identity in order to survive in the Khmer Rouge labor camps. She worked as a dishwasher by day and by night in the cover of darkness. darkness, she would practice the intricate hand gestures of her art as not to forget it. So let me welcome Chana Sath, who will be dancing the Chui Chai dance.
Thank you.
dance we're going to see is part of Cambodian folk dance. Folk dance is rooted in rituals in everyday village life. The dancers honor skills that are typically undervalued in the rush towards westernization, such as fishing, rice farming. The dance motifs are common based on local legends and inspired by themes of nature, as well as ceremonies and customs that shape the lives of Khmer people. Just as classical dance is ruled by strict form and prescribed language of movement, folk dance is spontaneous, created for emotional expression. Costumes are very colorful and reflect the traditional dress in a particular province or an ethnic group within Cambodia, where the dance originates. Before I tell you about the Poy Soi dance, I just want to let everyone know, if you're on social media, so are we. So be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, all those things. We have a website, angkordance.org, if you want to learn more, if you want to bring us to your school. I know people are here from all over, so be sure to check us out. So the Poy Soi dance, the exciting and fast-paced Poy Soi folk dance, belongs to the Soi ethnic group who lives near the Oral Mountain Range in Kampong's Bu province. The Soi perform this dance annually in dedication to the cave spirit and other gods who are believed to protect their community. Please help me welcome the Poy Soi dance.
thank you again for being here at our reception and opening event for the Crossing Borders, Bridging Cultures, Remapping Identities in Southeast Asia. It is a Bridging Cultures event. We are very fortunate to be one of the cohort leaders for the East-West Center Asian Studies Development Program's Bridging Cultures Grant. We are also cohort leaders for the AACU Bridging Cultures Grant. And so we like to combine efforts, and we like to think of it as one big family in the Asian tradition. So again, thank you for being here. It is my great pleasure to welcome our keynote speaker, Barbara Watson Andaya. She is a professor of Asian Studies and former director of the Center for Southeast Asian Studies at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. In 2005 and 2006, she was president of the American Association of Asian Studies. She was educated at the University of Sydney and received her MA at the University of Hawaii and PhD at Cornell University. She teaches and researches all across Southeast Asia, but her specific area of expertise is in the Western Malay Indonesia archipelago. John Simon Guggenheim Award she was awarded John Simon Guggenheim Award, which resulted in a flaming womb positioning women in Southeast Asian history, 1500 to 1800. That was published in 2006. Last year, she received a University of Hawaii Regents Medal for Excellence in Research. She's currently collaborating on a history of Southeast Asia in the early modern period, as well as researching in localization in Christianity in Southeast Asia from 1511 to 1900. It's my great pleasure to welcome Barbara Watson Andaya as our keynote. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Donna. I'm a classroom teacher, so I'm fantastically stuck behind the podium. Can you all hear me? Can I talk like this? Yes. So just wave your hand if you can. Well, first of all, I want to thank Donna. Thank you all. I want to thank the Bridging Cultures personnel organization for bringing me here and just hearing the story of Paul's arriving. I want to thank you on his behalf. The program that we're going to have this tonight, tomorrow, today is concerned with remapping, thinking about ways remapping Southeast Asia, thinking of different kinds of connections that could be drawn. And my talk tonight, my presentation tonight, you see the slides numbered down the right-hand side, and it's divided in six parts. So if you get terribly bored, you can just look down at the numbers. I think I have four slides, but they're very quick. She's only got 25 to go. What do we think of in mapping our world? Well, this is a kind of typical map you might see. And what we think of it when we, in intellectual imagery, there's lots of bright spots, as they used to say with the British Empire. What a lovely pink map all over the globe, you know. But we think in terms of landscapes, of contiguous areas, of countries that have specific borders, and the sea is just kind of there. It's not particularly interesting, it's just a blue place that we fly over. It's amazing to think that Paul and I were in Hawaii just hours or days, in your case. Still, we got here. And we flew over. Now, today, people don't see the sea as alive with life, but in a time when people had to cross water, was on a boat, and they crossed the sea got a very different kind of framework, or a different kind of image in people's minds. It was monsters, and it was large fish, and you could see the fish just walked the boat to land. And when you see, and then it's a little bit 1570, but you see this in the
life.
It's not a place that you fly over. And the representation of ocean from the time when people really started to draw land reveals some interesting aspects, particularly if you start moving into Asia. When Ptolemy, the geographer Ptolemy, drew a map, the one that really continued to influence European mapping right in the 15th and 16th century, you can still see that influence there. He can see of an area between Africa and there is a slugged enclosed lake, single lake. And people commented, of course, that should be wrong, you know, it really wasn't a single lake at all. But I think he got it right, because he saw the sea as an area of interaction with the lake, with people where people were involved. And you could see that much more clearly on this, which was found in Egypt only about 11 years ago, 2000. It was very recent. And this is a map you can see really here. It's from the book on the if anyone's interested. You could see a map of the ocean from to China. And if you could see the Arabic here, and all these ports along the way, there's a few islands here where people stop to get water, and you could where you find trees if your masts broke and so forth. Is Tioman, Port Tioman, which is stopped up just off the coast of the east coast of Asia. Today, this makeup, the seas were at a place where people and interacted and bought food and found markets, got water, and met people, made connections. And I'd like to think to this part of the world, the amazing thing about the world is that it connects people that otherwise wouldn't be connected to us. They would live in, and you could see that very clearly in some of the first American expedition to Sumatra. Because in 1795, left sailing for Sumatra with and he got to Sumatra with no help at all. Wow. He got to the west coast of Sumatra with just a pilot. He found a pilot, a local pilot, who would take him. But people, the Irish who drove him to some port, he found a nice pilot would take him to the place. And he went there, he bought a load of pepper, lost on a reef, but he came back to Salem with the stories of this remarkable place. He went again, so he did it for 18 months this time. And he came back, he had all kinds of things. These are just subtle things he brought back. There's a here, a large oyster shell, elephant tooth, that's what it says in the book. A pipe with two stems, you can see this here. Boxes, plates, we describe the plates. I don't know whether I assume it's in the museum somewhere, because they form the nucleus of the Salem East Indian Museum, and they became part of the people's museum. So they're presumably still. My point is this connection between Salem, Sumatra. These things have biography. They make people imagine. But it's an overused word, but a souvenir is makes you feel right. Remember who, how you are. These funny things that are in the list, this petrified cat, a large shell. I don't think he just found them somewhere. Somebody had thought they were special. These objects often have a special quality in this part of the world. They were seen as having sort of life of their own or being very unusual circumstances. And that also went to that same area in the museum. somewhere down the back, I don't know, but these pepper bags were brought in, beautiful pepper bags for the board now. Again, this would be a board market. This had given a present. So, when we see this kind of voyage, friendship that they always to replica, also an Siemens of Sumatra, the native language. So these are objects that see that come to us down over centuries of sea travel because of the connection that were made through these maritime world. And it reminds us that the sea is not, my first slide, not just a blue space. Especially in the when the only way people could cross the sea was physically get on it. You couldn't just fly. I mean, there are all kinds of things that happen. And your victory between you and the land were always very close. The time at the 18th and 19th century, there. You could show this is Lanka here. These connections between the sea and the land are obviously very close, as you mean in water and have these kinds of connections between sea and sea is really an extension of the land. And for many people, I work in Indonesia and Malaysia particularly, as Donna said, and kids, and for them, sea going, and for them, getting in a boat is like getting in a boat. I mean, they can all row things that I think they're only three rowing, but you know, they can do all this. And the way our children would just get a little ride a tricycle. It's I remember being in Holland once, of course, everyone rides bicycles there, and said to me, the trouble with non-Dutch people is when you get on a bike, you think on a bike. We don't think of it just like our hand, or just an extension of ourselves. And for maritime people, truly maritime people, that's how boats are. So now I want to turn, be happy to see, I want to think about Southeast Asia from the sea, to try and think about ways that don't privilege the land, don't privilege the nations, don't privilege the way we come to think of the land. And it's a concept of Southeast Asia that the land divides and sea unites. If you look at much of the region, especially in the islands of Borneo, Sumatra, Java, mountainous, jungle, forest, and it's quite difficult to penetrate. It's much easier to go by sea. Of course, the system that operates in much of the area makes sea travel relatively predictable when the winds come from the east, this way, when they come from the south, then you can go that way, but there are local breezes and local winds as well. So sea travel can become quite predictable. You know where you can go, you know where the currents are, and so forth. So the sea unites, and that is because the most of Southeast Asia, I'm just going to the next slide, just for a minute, most of Southeast Asia, of islands of Southeast Asia, you can see the mainland is cut off here, but most of islands of Southeast Asia, so we talk about modern Malaysia, Singapore, and the Philippines, and of course the Pacific Islands, New Zealand as well, people by groups speaking Austronesian languages, enormous Austronesian languages, especially all the way to Madagascar, can start child of Taiwan, probably about 4,000 or more years ago, people much in this area. So they came by boat, and I'll pick that up later on. So that boat culture is thinking about the world in terms of sea travel is very, very old in Southeast Asia. It came to much of the region with the very first. In a different kind of a way, just concentrate on the land. And this tendency to privilege the land, especially in islands of Asia, has been complicated by, tell me if I'm going to be away in a way, complicated by the colonial drew up the nations of Philippines, Indonesia, Malaysia. It took no note whatsoever. Connection that the boundaries of these new states are into land, the occupation of the land, rather than continue to cause problems. So we have migration of the sea of Southeast Asia. And within a couple of geographic sides, just to complicate the picture a little bit further. This large area, if you look here, you see that there's a kind of white area on this side and a white area with bluish middle. And that is made clear in the next slide, which is a reminder of even this large going world, there is still a lot of variation. And one of the reasons for variation is geographic. You could see here on the left-hand side what is called Sunda Shelf. So that part is actually an extension of the mainland. If you go over water, you land connection, were land connections once. On the other side, over here, you can see the Southern Shelf. And here, if you drop all water, Australia and New Guinea would be connected. There was a land bridge there at one time. Between them is a very deep line. And that was first the implications of that. The fact that these are two separated areas that have been separated for a very, very, very long time was made apparent, or was really recognized in the 19th century by Alfred Wallace, that the flood of
paradigm,
which are being used, you don't find them on the west side. On the east side, the largest animal is the pig, whereas on the other side, the largest animal is the bird.
Wow.
So you don't. The big difference means in the western side, in the east side, sorry, the pig became the rich animal. That was the animal you killed for feasting, and it was a big one. It had big implications, but it's like it's an unclean animal. So, the implications of that tree divide for other areas and for communication, for the way in which national identities meant that this remote area of Western the eastern area became a maze of thousands upon thousands of carcasses of these beautiful birds were shipped to Europe for the feathers for people's hats, especially in the 18th and 19th century. So. That particular part is that when we approach Southeast Asia, let's dispense with contemporary nation states. Let's kind of think of other ways in which people might relate to each other, remembering that the very real geographical differences. It doesn't always mean that the city absolutely unites. Sometimes there's I want to take three areas of Southeast Asia just to talk a little bit about. The first would be the Malacca Straits, the second the Java Sea, that circle pulled down a bit lower, and the Sulu Sea. So the Malacca Straits, you can see here, if you want to go from India to China, there are only two sea passages that you could use. One was the Malacca Straits, and was Sunda, just between Sumatra and Java. But that meant sailing around this area. It was quite precious because the South Pole is down here, and there's nothing between the South Pole and this west coast of Sumatra. The seas can be quite rough at certain times of the year. So the Malacca Straits, which are really like an inland lake in many ways, are where it's still one of the most used passages in the world. And it's on the high road between India and China. And the common language of this area was Malay on both sides of the Malacca Straits. People intermarried. Even today you go from Penang to across to Haydang, we thought it would be good for this participant hated, I think. They found the trip very long, 7 hours. It wasn't too bad. So that's the longest trip. But the round here, of course, the connection is very, very good. So the common language is Malay, the common language from the early 15th century Islam. So prestigious in the 15th century, as most probably know, it was the distribution for spices from Eastern Asia. It was the exchange center for textiles from India, from goods from China, and it was the gateway for Europe to enter Southeast Asia world, and that's why it was conquered by the Portuguese in 1511. One of the Portuguese commentator said, he who holds Malacca has his hand on the throat of Venice. So if you could control Malacca, you could control the spice trade. So, but Malacca is so prestigious that its court culture, its language, Malay, its religion, its style of dress, everything was copied in the neighboring. And I mentioned before that the colonial meant little to colonial interests. So in 1824, when the Dutch and the English divided the region to stop conflict, they lined down the upper strait, so the British said, we won't try to get any settlement below the line. The Dutch said, well, we won't. Promise not to get influence and try and get our sphere of influence north of that. So that became the continued border between modern Malaysia and Indonesia. But it still creates enormous problems because most of the illegal migrants from Indonesia into Malaysia today are from Sumatra. Because the connections here are very strong. And one of the officials, when he heard about this treaty, he said, we do understand the dispensation of Allah that has caused this to his allies to come about, parting brother from brother, father from son, and friend from friend. Because of course of our cultural world. Change the configuration, and I didn't change it too well, but it's the area that I'm going to talk about is this northern area, this Java Sea here, which developed what the northern coast of Java and the southern coast of Borneo developed what has been something called the Pacific culture. Pacific means coastal area. Very cosmopolitan, which is a mixture of Javanese, of European, of Chinese or Arab urban ports along the north coast and along the southern coast of Borneo share a similar kind of culture. Chinese, Arab, Javanese, this mixed Asian, what they call Portuguese, is wearing a style hat, but you can see see they've got in the background shows Christian, not. And one of the texts, from the coast of Borneo records that relationship with Java, made them part of the cultural that in our customs we follow only the customs of Java, because that's where our ancestors come from. This organization is perfect. Courts and our society is perfect because it's just like that of coastal Java. That's where they saw their world. Even though they're divided on them by water, they saw it as part of this world. And they felt that this persistent coastal culture that they shared with Java set them apart from these often headhunting, these non-Islamic interior groups whose lifestyle was very different from the Pacific culture. And the third group I wanted to were those people who lived down the sea, the southern Philippines and today in Borneo. A number of different types of groups, sea-dwelling people, Bajau, different groups, but all together by related languages and a lifestyle directed towards trade and sea. And there is now divided between Malaysia and the Philippines. So again, the colonial powers took notice of these maritime connections, but there is still these
about that suburbs area here. Sahar belongs to us, belongs to Sulu, belongs to Sulu. So this was very recently, people from Sulu trying to land in Sahar and trying to take it. So this is a connected world. These cities, and these are just three, but you could apply the same kind of approach to others of these internal cities that dot the region. So think of the sea as a place not just for blue on the map, but as one geographer said, a theatre of action. We can approach it in different ways. We can think about perceiving meaning in people's lives. What do these little societies mean? And you'll see in the article I wrote some time ago, it's in your package. I cite some of the people who worked on literal societies in parts of the world. They've asked that people along the coast, people who lived across the coast of Germany and the southern coasts of England, had more in common with each other than they did with interior societies in their own countries. So these literal societies, that they didn't really, and the same in South Asia, doesn't matter whether they're on the coast of Vietnam or the coast of Thailand, off the map here, but the or the Philippines, they share a common approach to the sea. And that idea of the sea as a theatre of action, a living space, is no better exemplified than in the sea. Really a Southeast Asian phenomenon. These are not land people who've taken to the sea, like the boat people of Hong Kong and people who couldn't find homes on the land. These are people who've lived on the sea. So that's where their life is. Don't take them. They really don't understand their behavior. They don't like them. They want people to sell land and have a land registered somewhere. They don't like people going around. So the Orang Lapas, which is the sea people, some of the Bay Peninsula, the southern Bahau, were very active in southern Philippines, also in the western areas, the eastern areas of Indonesia. For them, this is their life. We have a student now at Hawaii who's doing a history thesis on the Banjar of Indonesia. Amazing. People think they have history. But it's amazing the record, the songs that they have that tell their history, their stories, the sophistication of their knowledge just extraordinary. They're without maps, without that, they know exactly where they go. And they see their home. But they have within the city, they have areas of areas that is their harvesting. Hunt for sea cucumbers or corals or seaweed or whatever they're selling to the local market. And we can see this Austronesian heritage also comes out in Austronesia. There are a number of islands throughout the Indonesian archipelago that are called Bangka. It just means boat. But you could see here on these islands called Bangka because it's a dean, it's a little, it's a Martha's boat, and this is the boat going along the side. So you find an island off the ground called Bangka. And in Philippines, Bangka means village. The relation to that is that where the original people came in a ship group on the boat, and that Bangka formed the basis for the village. But there are two various interpretations. But one is that the boat appearing runes come again from that old tradition. There are very interesting things in architecture done
the University of Salisbury. He took houses in, looking particularly at Indonesia, but houses, and showed how the relationship of the entire building of the house to ship construction, the internal poles and the way that the, where the kitchen was, and the main part of the house that will be a quaint part of both the traditional house. But this is also a place for traveling and for kinship. I like this picture of an Eastern Indonesia, but these are people who are going to visit relatives on the island. So they're dancing and they're singing, having, this is going to be a wonderful occasion, probably going to something like, in the bottom. A river or moving across the sea, but that's particularly evident in South Asia, which is but you can see the top here, which has the travelers crossing, taking the seas across the seas to the next. Like in the napkins and so on, but this way you can see it through the movement of what happened, whether it's going to be a good year, especially for the year for the rice, a bad year for the rice. This is the Kalahera and Maruku, a very annual cleansing of the ocean when people are in their families, and all these people are Christians or Muslims. Java to the surface of the South Ocean, who is still believed to be the mistress of Jakarta, who said Java. She had made this children come down this old house where there's a picture. This is the ocean. Every year they have special ceremonies where they offer. When she's angry, tsunamis and their earthquakes, all kinds of things happen. When they're going to be offering to the southern are ignored or put in submission. Also, too, there are great animals in the ocean that also need veneration. This is most pronounced in Vietnam, and I think it's new ideas from. They come by telepathy. by the Ruling. And it's not Buddhism. You see already the series has been part of many remarkable stories of the Buddha that picked the Buddha and had an important role in the start of his earlier lives.
Understand to explain these quite difficult
difficult ideas. And one of the most interesting is Chaya Prao, so Bhopal, which is a poem, and it compares spiritual boat. Make your rigging fast, estuary where you must pass a shallow, take care your boat doesn't sink, fasten your rigging, pull in your oars, lay your anchor, hoist your sail, when it goes on safe, you're going to find storms, it's going to be difficult, you have to keep the faith, you will get there, keep your eye on the compass, you know, or on the stars, you know. The whole spiritual journey is like a boat, and that's what people could then understand. And even Christianity, of course, is the last of the great world religions to reach Southeast Asia. It's a minority religion except in the Philippines and Timor, but still it's 10% of Indonesia's population is now 258 million, so 10% of that is quite a lot. There's about 7% in Vietnam, so it's not substantial. But of course the disciples as fishermen, people like that idea, the story of Christ calming the storm is very popular in Southeast Asian Christian paintings and representations. But perhaps most important was the visionary Stella Maris, the star of the sea, the protector of those. She often can see the picture of the Maris, which for Vietnamese, she often got conflated. And this the crescent moon that she's standing, which is taken from Revelations, the queen stand, is often converted to a boat, not in this picture, but you often find indigenous pictures with her standing on a boat in the sea. And in the Philippines, the devotion to Mara is often linked to older ideas of water deities. They're conflated together as well. So this statue of the Virgin of Apollo, who originally came from Mexico, you can see it from a dark face, but it went back and forward many times on ships, protecting the ships and allegedly warning captains of storms coming. And here you can see a picture of the Virgin Mary protecting Manila from these Dutch ships that are attacking in 1646. And finally, this is I'm coming very close to the end, and it is getting late. While I've been talking about this case of communication, of interaction, of assuming an important role in ordinary people's lives, it was also a place potential danger as well. You could have shipwrecks, you could have tsunamis, but particularly also you could be attacked by and people could come with ideas, they could come with wealth, they could come with gifts, but they could also come with guns and cannon. And that was no better seen when the Europeans started coming, because all great victories were attacks up until the 19th century came by sea. So you can see this picture of an attack by the Dutch. You can see how they just lined themselves up along the sea coast there, and they trained the cannon onto the houses there, and they were just into the place, nothing to get in or out. So this is a VAC attack. But there are also raiders as well. One these Ilaman from the southern Philippines, but I prefer to call them raiders rather than pirates. The search for slaves, raiding for slaves, really took off when Europeans arrived, because they needed so many slaves to work on plantations, to build cities, for domestic servants and so on. So of course there had been slaves before. By the 17th century, the slave trade was enormous, and some of those raiders were locals, and you could see sometimes 100 rowers themselves, often slaves, very, very sophisticated tackling equipment, very, very sophisticated means of sailing, so that they would be very fearful as well. But also, we have to remember that the Southeast Asia, also like a of American interest as well. In 1831, there was in the early 19th century, 1805, 1831, there were quite a lot of confrontations between temporary ships and locals. I have done enough investigation to know the American story, of course, the local viewpoint of the Malays are always wrong, but I'm sure there's another side to the story. In Sumatra, a Malays attacked an American ship, and so the Roma here was sent to take revenge. And this is the first American engagement in Asia. And Andrew Jackson said, in justification, he said, a dead agent being beaten. And there was no room for negotiation because the perpetrators, the Malays, who originally attacked over, there'd been some disagreement about paper delivery, belonged to tribes in such a state of society that the usual course of proceedings between civilized nations cannot be pursued. So the Potomac was dispatched, and attack started, about 400 Malays were killed, and to the ground, but although there was some criticism at home, Jackson said it was important to show that America couldn't tribal. This attack would act as a deterrent to other attacks in the future, and as I said, it was the first American military engagement in Asia. So, in this presentation, I tried to pick up several issues, and I covered wide ground, I know, but I'd just like to leave you with three points. That a maritime perspective means we can imagine and see Southeast Asia in a way that doesn't privilege the land and doesn't necessarily focus on the kind of nation state drawn up in terms of territory and territorial boundaries. And secondly, that if we think about the sea and its importance, then we can understand that it functions not merely for economic purposes or as a trade service just to get things from here to there, for transport, but was deeply integrated into people's ideas about cosmos, about and religious activities as well. And the argument that literal societies have more in common with each other than they do with inland societies in their own country is an intriguing one because it opens the door for thinking about more comparative work in which you can take South Asian examples and link them to coastal societies in other parts of the world. So with that thought, I'll stop. I thank you for your patience. And I thank you. And questions?
Thank you very much, Barbara. Are there any questions for tonight? Do you have any questions for her?
No, comment. I really appreciate what you presented, and it really reinforces the point that we need to go beyond our studies into zones of interaction. Mediterranean, rotary down the Indian Ocean, and also the Indian Ocean, looks at the Indian Ocean as a zone of interaction. And so you present more arguments for that, that we look Healy Coast, look at the coast, the southern coast of India, look at the Straits of Malacca, the entire Maritime Southeast Asia. The relationships between them are very dynamic, cultural producing, and not base stations to trade.
No.
Thank you very much.
And I think this is important for our students as well.
the information that we'll be getting tonight, as well as the next 2 days. I mean, it's going to be directly important for our students. And we need to make sure that the information that we give them is that these are sorts of interaction, and that when they think about the modern world, they can't look at lines on a map. That there are so many interactions.
Well, you need some historical.
Set the world history professor. I need it.
Japanese settlement. I mean, how did they get there? They and some Southeast Siam trade with Japan using Chinese sailors, ships. Vietnam still sailing. So, but the Japanese were not supposed to be going over. But if you actually look at Japanese coastal cultures, if you look at, and Korean coastal cultures, and you look and talk about one of the interesting things that developed. Both those countries, for example, is female divers. Now, as far as I know, in Southeast Asia, there are no female divers. But we do have in Japan and Korea. And that, I've never really found out why it was that the pearl diver and the other, you know, the other particular, why it was that women was considered, you know, good at that. So, you know, I think, and as I said, the whale, army in Japan that deal with water, but a lot of them are inland lakes and rivers and so on, rather than the ocean. But I think very different if Japan had continued operations and was sending 3 ships a year sometimes to Southeast Asia at the beginning of the 20th century. And all that, and they're all crewed by Japan. And all that stopped until the 19th century. So I think if you the sea has not attracted a lot of historical attention even prior to the 19th century and even after that. It hasn't attracted a lot of Japanese historiography, but if you scratch the surface, I think you can see that it is quite important for people who live around the sea.
Yes.
So, as I said, these whale eating whales, I mean, it's a big issue. present for environmentalists, but it is a ritual in many areas, and there are many, and the way in particular, as the animal veneration is very strong.
Someone.
Arousal, the coast, we're very close with them. But the, once you land, you land, you're going to have a look at your papers and